President Obama's inauguration made history. Tonight, we're learning how different it looked from the inside, different and terrifying. Details just now coming to light about a threat believed to be credible at the time to turn it into a bloodbath. The story being reported on the pages of an upcoming edition of the New York Times Magazine. Its author, Peter Baker, joins us now by phone. Peter, what was the alleged threat and how seriously did officials take it?
Well, it was in some intelligence that indicated that there were a group of Somalis who intended to come to Washington to detonate explosives on the National Mall, where the President of the United States, of course, would be taking the oath of office on January 20th and addressing the world with his inaugural address. They took it quite seriously in the last 48 to 72 hours before the inauguration. Increasingly, they were picking up signs that made them feel like this was a serious and possible threat. They met repeatedly with each other, the old team, the Bush team, and the new team, the Obama team, during this transition period in order to try to figure out what to do about it. And it was a moment of some quiet tension there for a new president as he was just about to take office.
I understand President Obama even canceled a rehearsal of the inauguration. When was the president actually briefed, and do you know what his reaction was?
Well, he was kept up to date in the few days leading up to the inauguration. There's one moment in particular we write about in the magazine. The night before the inauguration, his counterterrorism advisor, John Brennan, and a couple of foreign policy advisors jump into the limousine with him as he's heading off to one of the inaugural events to tell him the latest they had heard and what everything was being done about this. One of the things that the new administration and the old administration agreed was they would keep Robert Gates, the defense secretary, away from the inauguration in a secure location, a secret location, just in case the worst happened and everybody in the line of succession were to be killed in a catastrophic event, he'd be able to take over the presidency.
In your article, you also wrote that Hillary Clinton was at a meeting with Bush officials, Condoleezza Rice and others, and Hillary Clinton pointedly asked what the president would do if the attack took place in the middle of the inauguration address, whether they were going to, you know, hustle him off the stage in the middle of the inauguration. Do you know what they had decided if that scenario had unfolded?
Well, I mean, there wasn't a whole lot of options. Obviously, the Secret Service would have to do what it would have to do to protect the incoming president. But, you know, what she was pointing to was a very real danger. It wasn't just the danger that a bomb would go off and somebody would be killed, particularly the president would be killed. It was a danger that something could happen that would send a signal of weakness at the very inception of a brand new presidency, that a brand new president at the very moment he's taking office would be shown to be vulnerable in front of the eyes of the world. That was a big, big concern for them, even on top of the actual violence itself they worried about.
And was there ever any talk of moving the inauguration site or anything like that?
No, they weren't going to do anything like that. They just simply determined to make it as secure as they possibly could. I mean, there are, you know, terrorist threats regularly that the government is investigating, like this one. And like this one, some of them don't turn out to be real. This turned out to be what we call a poison pan, what the intelligence people call a poison pan.
Well, that's what really fascinated me. Your article, John Brennan, who is now Obama's top counterterrorism official, called it this poison pan, which is basically a rumor plan by one extremist sect in an effort to kind of get the U.S. into attacking one of its rivals. Is that correct?
Right, exactly. He sensed early on this had the possibility of being that kind of thing. And what that really tells us is just how difficult it is when you're president, whether it be George Bush or Barack Obama, trying to figure out what's real in this murky world of terrorism and extremism, what's not real. And I think that, you know, came to light again on Christmas Day. You know, how do we know which passengers who are in a system of 550,000 names might be somebody who might be a genuine threat as opposed to somebody who just happens to be in the system because of some random bits of information. And that's what the government is trying to wrestle with even now this week.
It also shows you and reminds you the importance of having experienced intelligence officers, I guess like John Brennan, you know, who can identify whether something is a poison pen or whether it's, you know, some other kind of game afoot. It's a fascinating story. Peter Baker from the New York Times Magazine. Appreciate you being with us from a New York Times correspondent, a White House correspondent, Peter Baker on the phone with us from Hawaii. Some